Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Back from the Future, a celebration of the greatest time travel story ever told, by Brad Gilmore, narrated by Joe Hempel. Prologue: How the Past Brought on the Future. June 9th, 2019. Great Scott! I can't believe I am writing a book. A book! What in the name of Sir Isaac H. Newton is going on here? Somebody must have been sitting too close to the Hill Valley clock tower when lightning struck it and made a grave mistake. Never mind that. It's happening, whether the space-time continuum wants it to happen or not. I am writing a book about Back to the Future. It's not just any film franchise to me. It's the franchise. As I write this today, June 9th, the same day as Michael J. Fox's birthday, I'm thinking about how this journey began for me. How did it come to be that I would have the honor of doing a deep dive into a series that is loved around the world? Allow me to provide some background on how this book came to be. I was hanging a clock in my bathroom in 1999 when I slipped and fell. When I came to, I had a vision. A vision of this. Actually, I could only wish that's what happened. Here's the real story. In 1999, I was just 7 years old and had gotten home to start my after-school tradition. That tradition was to change out of my school uniform, take my shoes off, pay no attention to any homework I had, play with my next-door neighbor, Emerson, and then go to my room. My room, for some reason, had bunk beds even though I had no siblings close to my age, and there was no way my brother, 23 years older than me, would want to take the top bunk. But once I arrived in my fortress of solitude, I would find the remote and turn on the Disney Channel. Disney Channel was awesome when I was a kid. You had Boy Meets World, Lizzie McGuire, Even Stevens, and others that I'm sure I'm forgetting. Anyhow, Disney Channel would always show a movie at 7 o'clock Central, but something odd happened with the schedule one fateful evening. Instead of a Disney Channel original movie playing, there was a marathon planned for that evening. 3 time travel films of which I had never heard prior to that day. Now, let's take a pause there just for a second. I mean, we have all the time in the world, right? Many fans of Back to the Future will know the famous story that Bob Gale and Robert Zemeckis, the co-writers of the film, tell about pitching their idea for a time travel story. The idea they pitched was a story about a boy who goes back in time and accidentally interrupts his parents' first meeting, which led to his mother falling in love with him and caused him to never be born in the future. As the story goes, every studio they met with said they were looking for a raunchier 1980s comedy, and this film seemed to have too much of a soft side. The heads of all the major studios told Bob and Bob the same thing. You know what? You should pitch this to Disney. They would love it. So Bob and Bob took this advice and went to Disney, which told them they were out of their minds if they thought the House of Mouse would ever produce a film with an incestual relationship between a mother and her son. I don't blame them for this. Back to the Future's plot could be worrisome if you didn't see the film that eventually came. Either way, Disney wanted no parts of the odd story Bob and Bob had concocted. I tell the story because eventually, I experienced the greatest cinematic adventure in movie history for the first time, ironically, on the Disney Channel. I will never forget it, sitting there on the lower bunk when the title card that came across my television screen read, "Up Next, Back to the Future." From the moment I heard the title, I knew I was locked in. The idea of time travel was fascinating. And when I saw the DeLorean time machine and Doc Brown and the music and Marty's life preserver, I had entered a world where I felt at home. That night, one film into the next, I stayed up way past my bedtime to watch the stories Gale and Zemeckis had dreamed up. The next morning, thankfully a Saturday, I ran down the stairs as my parents were making a sweet southern breakfast of scrambled eggs, pigs in a blanket, and grits, and told them about this phenomenal story I saw last night on the Disney Channel. I begged and pleaded with my parents to take me to the local Blockbuster so I could rent these 3 movies and dive back into their world. My mother obliged, as she always did when she could tell I truly wanted something. And we drove down to Blockbuster that moment. Well, not that moment exactly, because I couldn't leave those eggs just sitting there. After finishing my feast, I entered the blue and yellow cladded Blockbuster, went straight to the science fiction section, and found the trilogy. Sadly, Back to the Future Part 3 was rented out, and I could only rent Parts 1 and 2. As soon as I got back to the house, I ran to the linen closet and grabbed a large, pink, hand-woven blanket of my grandmother's, that in my mind was made in 1955, off the shelf. I took that blanket and some art supplies to the room in the house with the largest, albeit square, television set, and spread the blanket in the middle of the room. I dumped my bucket of art supplies, an assortment of colored pencils, ink pens, and crayons, and did my best to draw blue sparks and red lightning designs on white printer paper so I could place them on either side of the blanket to imitate the flux capacitor at full flux. As soon as I believed my calculations were correct and my version of the time machine was ready for temporal displacement, I went 88 miles per hour back to what should be the United States of America's capital, Hill Valley, California, and the world that Gale and Zemeckis created. To say the very least, I was obsessed. There's no other word to use for it. Like many kids, when something catches your attention, you latch onto it and dive in headfirst. Similar to the way I was with the WWF starting in 1998, Back to the Future claimed a large part of real estate in my brain. I could not wait to get back to Edgar Allan Poe Elementary School Monday morning to tell my friends about these brand new movies I had just discovered. To my surprise, I was the only one who watched that Disney Channel marathon over the weekend. Even more troublesome to me was that no one else in Mrs. Gray's first grade class had even heard of the films. Before we move further, I want to let you know that I did do my due diligence during that time. I felt it was rather odd I had just watched these films and that I had a teacher who shared her surname with a popular book of sports statistics. I approached Mrs. Gray before lunch one day, and I did indeed inquire if she had written the Gray's Sports Almanac. I thought I had a lot of circumstantial evidence, since we're nearing the end of the 20th century with the year 2000 quickly approaching, and I thought the fact she was an English teacher was suspect because writing a book would not be out of the realm of possibility for someone with her skill. So, needless to say, I thought the chances were rather high that she penned the book that would cause Marty, Doc and Company, such great angst and peril. Once I confronted her with all of this information, Mrs. Gray quickly denied any involvement or connection with the creation of the almanac. All these years later, I'm not so sure I can take her at her word, but I've moved on. Back to the Future became my life, and it's all I could think about. Just a couple years later, I would become even more connected to the series in a way I never thought I would. Most kids, if they're lucky, have both a mom and a dad in their lives, but they are really fortunate if they have a relationship with their grandparents. I was one of the lucky ones. I saw my grandparents every day after school. My grandparents were more than just my mother's parents. They were my second mother and father, and two of my closest friends. That is what made my grandmother's diagnosis of Parkinson's disease so tough. When I was 9 years old, I didn't know the severity of the condition, but I was more than aware of it because my cinematic idol's real-life counterpart, Michael J. Fox, suffered from the same diagnosis. Over the next several years, I saw the disease take a toll on my grandmother's body. She eventually succumbed to it in 2016 after more than a decade of battling the disease. I share this because her diagnosis brought me even closer to these films. And Michael J. Fox became a symbol of hope for me, my family, and others who were affected by Parkinson's. Fox's raising of awareness, funds, and research through the Michael J. Fox Foundation has greatly benefited so many people. I support the foundation on a daily basis by wearing my Team Fox bracelet that matches the colors of the Back to the Future logo. I will forever love Michael J. Fox, not just for these films, but for doing everything he does to find a cure for this horrific ailment. Michael is truly a man who believes, if you put your mind to it, you can accomplish anything. I continued my love for Back to the Future and consumed all the content I could get my hands on. With each release of an anniversary edition of the films, I happily spent my money so I could see new special features and learn more about my favorite franchise. In the months leading up to the actual year 2015, which Doc, Marty, Jennifer, and Einstein travel to in Back to the Future Part 2, I wanted to see what was out there as far as a countdown to Future Day. In 2015, podcasts were starting to boom, and you could find a show covering whatever you wanted. There was the Steve Austin Show, hosted by Stone Cold himself, covering the world of wrestling. Adam Carolla and Marc Maron continued their dominance of the genre after being two of its earliest adopters. There was even a show called Signcast, which covered all 180 episodes of the iconic 1990 series, Seinfeld. An interesting bit of trivia for fans of Seinfeld and Back to the Future: a VHS copy of Back to the Future Part 3 is on Jerry's shelf in his apartment during the run of the show. With literally hundreds of thousands of podcasts, I was sure one show covered the world of Back to the Future given the popularity of the series and the impending Future Day. Upon several searches on my iPhone in the Apple Podcast Store for such a show, I couldn't believe one had yet to be created. At the time, I was hosting my own radio show in Houston and was co-hosting a sports show with two-time WWE Hall of Famer Booker T on a local AM station. Instead of waiting for someone else to create this podcast, I saw an opportunity to share my love of the movies with thousands of other people. Back to the Future, the podcast, was born. On April 24th, 2015, I launched the podcast and soon after spoke with several people involved with the films. In the first five episodes of the show, I spoke with Claudia Wells, who played Jennifer Parker in Back to the Future. I had an in-depth discussion with Kevin Pike, who was the special effects supervisor and an integral part of the DeLorean time machine. Jeffrey Weissman, who took over the role of George McFly in Parts 2 and 3 after Crispin Glover's departure, also graced me with an interview. I couldn't believe I got to talk to people who were either in the films or worked on them. The podcast took on a life of its own. Since 2015, we have had five full seasons of the show, and the special guests continued to come. I've talked to Stephen Wynn, owner of DeLorean Motor Company, which came with a personal tour of the DeLorean headquarters, Harry Waters Jr., Marvin Berry, Stephen Clark, executive director of BackToTheFuture.com, and others. While writing this book and planning the sixth season of the podcast, I got the chance to interview Crispin Glover for the show and talk about his role as George McFly, which we will discuss more in the chapters ahead. Thousands of people discover the show all the time, and I am overwhelmed by the amount of emails, messages, and tweets I received each week from pinheads the world over. I decided it was time to take the next step in expressing my love for the world of Back to the Future by writing a book covering the time travel saga. In this book, we'll talk about how a germ of an idea turned into an entire universe. We'll cover what actually happened in 2015 and how close it was to what was depicted in the films. We'll debate who the best characters are and discuss theories that have never been explored in any book before. Now that the three films which have the word future in their titles are now all set ironically in the past, we will discuss why they are so damn rewatchable, why they are generational, and why they are timeless now that we are officially back from the future. Part 1. Time Circuits On. Chapter 1. The History of Hill Valley. Back to the Future is, without a doubt in my mind, the greatest trilogy of films in the history of cinema. There has been no other standalone series of three films that have rivaled its blockbuster success. Many people might bring up Star Wars in response to that statement, but there are now nine films in the Skywalker saga alone. Indiana Jones had a really good shot at besting the time travel trilogy, but a fourth installment of the series was released in 2008, and a planned fifth film with Harrison Ford returning as the famous archaeologist is in the works as I write this book. The Marvel Cinematic Universe, MCU, has over two dozen films, as does the James Bond series, which takes them both out of contention. Back to the Future's only real competition in terms of a true trilogy is the Godfather series by Francis Ford Coppola. But I still give the edge to Back to the Future for two reasons. First, let's be honest, Back to the Future Part 3 is way better than The Godfather Part 3. And second, I'm writing a book about Back to the Future, so I am a tad biased. Biases aside, Back to the Future captured the attention of everyone worldwide when it was released in July of 1985. The summer hit became the highest-grossing film that year, besting Rambo: First Blood Part 2, Rocky IV, A View to a Kill, and the other Christopher Lloyd cult classic, Clue. But how did a germ of an idea writer Bob Gale had while looking through his father's yearbook turn into one of the most beloved franchises in the history of cinema? Well, it started the same way Back to the Future's story does, with two friends who go on an incredible and fantastical journey. Robert Zemeckis and Bob Gale first met during their enrollment in the film program at the University of Southern California. Zemeckis was born on May 14, 1952, in Chicago, Illinois, and was enamored with television and using his parents' 8mm film camera to film birthdays and other family events. When Zemeckis learned he could attend film school from an episode of The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson, Bob Z, as members of the cast and crew of Back to the Future referred to him, made arrangements to chase his dream of being a Hollywood filmmaker and attended the University of Southern California. Bob Gale was born in May of 1951 in University City, Missouri. Gale had a fascination with movies and comic books. When Gale was a young teen, he created his own comic book series called The Green Vomit and founded a comic book club in St. Louis. Gale, always interested in being a writer, followed the path of density, or destiny, to USC and met Zemeckis. The two quickly became friends over their love for big Hollywood movies. The two began working on a script called Bordello of Blood, a film about vampire prostitutes, and thought this would be the first film the two would work on together. Although they didn't get Bordello made at the time, it later would be made into a TV movie for Tales from the Crypt, they both enjoyed working together. The duo continued to write together and even wrote an episode for a short-lived horror series called Kolchak, The Night Stalker. The show starred Darren McGavin as a newspaper reporter who would investigate mysterious crimes and lasted for only one season. Gale and Zemeckis wrote the episode titled Chopper, a fun watch for those who haven't seen the episode, or the show for that matter. With an official writing credit to their names, the Bobs would go on to write another television show called McCloud, and then Forget Christy Love. The duo was working well together, so well that NBC approached them both with contracts of $50,000 a year each for 7 years to write TV shows for the network. The Bobs took the offer to their new set of entertainment lawyers and agents, who suggested they turn down the offer. The Bobs wanted to produce movies, not television, so the two began their journey to Hollywood by visiting with a young director Zemeckis had met during a visit from that director to the USC campus. Steven Spielberg is perhaps the most well-known film director in history. Spielberg brought to life several films that impressed audiences globally, including Jaws, Close Encounters of the Third Kind, Raiders of the Lost Ark, E.T., Jurassic Park, and more. But before any of his major success, Spielberg was a young director trying to get a big break, but was almost earmarked by industry experts as someone to watch. Spielberg visited the USC campus to show his film, The Sugarland Express. Zemeckis was very impressed with what he saw, and he approached Spielberg after the screening and asked if Steven would view his Student Academy Award-winning film, A Field of Honor. Steven agreed, and the two watched the film together in Steven's office. In the not-too-distant future, Steven Spielberg would be directing a film the Bobs had written called 1941, a comedy set during World War II. The film was Spielberg's follow-up to Jaws and Close Encounters, so the film was expected to perform rather well at the box office. However, the film lost money in the domestic box office. This did not deter Steven from working with Gale and Zemeckis, however. Steven would work with the Bobs as an executive producer of Zemeckis' films, I Want to Hold Your Hand, and Used Cars. The two films, both written by Gale and Zemeckis and directed by the latter, weren't massive hits by any means, but they both had a distinct charm about them. Used Cars made a small amount of money at the box office, but the film got the attention of studio executive Frank Price. Used Cars received the highest score in a test screening that the film executive had ever seen during his time at Columbia Pictures. Price was a Midwesterner, like both Gale and Zemeckis, and was more than just a guy in a suit by the time he was in charge of Columbia Pictures. Price began his career in 1951 as a story editor and writer for several television shows under the CBS banner. Price would continue this work for nearly a decade until he met Sid Sheinberg, who would later have a pretty big influence on Back to the Future, and became a studio executive. Price worked for Universal TV as the senior vice president until 1978.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.